Aloha and welcome to The Experience on this windy day. I am your host, Jeremy Vaney, and this week's show is not at all anything I expected to do, but now I feel I must, and it starts with an apology for something that happened, something that was said during last week's episode with Buddy, the pseudonymous alien protocols guy. That slipped right by my radar. But before we get to that apology, a preamble. Anyone watching Night Flyers on the Sci-Fi Channel? It is essentially a show about a ragtag band of scientists, mavericks, who go looking for an alien life, what they think is going to be alien life. And they've joined up with a captain of a spaceship who's also interested in this for reasons unknown as of episode 6. But let's not go that far. Let's go back to episode 1. Whether you liked the show or not, if you saw episode 1, you saw the reason that they had to go out there in this maverick style is because the lead scientist made a presentation to his scientific colleagues that they were sort of into until they realized he was talking about, oh, wait, he wants to go looking for alien life, and that's a step too far for them. And so they all sort of get up and leave, and on their way out, the one sort of snarky colleague says to him something along the lines of, well, you know, don't feel too glum about this. At least you can write a book. And the implication being that scientists who write books are not really doing science, or at least they don't have to. They can just write anything they want. And while that may be just fine for Joe and Jane Public, it's a laughing stock amongst the colleagues. And I've heard that reflected actually in real life before ever seeing this show. And so what happens? Getting back to the show, the scientist forges on. And pretty early on, someone says, hey, what if these aliens don't want to be contacted? And his attitude is, I don't care. Viva la science. And so on they go, all of these professional PhDs on a ship that turns into sort of a haunted house story for a while. And, you know, everything that can go wrong will go wrong. And their reactions to things are completely unethical. And one would argue, namely this one, unethical because of the freedom they have, just like in writing a book, the freedom they have to kind of do whatever they want, unconfined to the rules and regulations of the very science that brung them to the game. So, let's stick a pin in that, and let's get to the apology for non-subscribers after these messages. Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen, without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
Whitley Strieber has published an incredible 2-volume historical novel called In Hitler's House, under his open pseudonym Jonathan Lane. This amazing story follows the life of William Weber, who meets Hitler while touring Germany in 1931, and becomes his friend and confidant, but then, when he realizes the truth, becomes a spy in Hitler's house for the Allies. Living a life of terrible danger, he falls in love with another of Hitler's secret friends, also a spy in his house. This is a story of espionage and desperate love, and the deepest portrait of Adolf Hitler ever created. Don't miss In Hitler's House, available in paperback and as an ebook on Amazon.
When I say I need to apologize, I hope I'm not just talking to myself. I hope I'm not doing this because of my own sense of ethics. I hope other people out there caught this. Although I fear not, or I fear people don't care. But either way, I apologize for not picking up on something that Buddy said in last week's episode that had I realized while we were recording, I would have stopped and dug down into this, but I was too busy in my head. You know, I'm guilty as charged of not always being the best listener, because as a host of a show, you want to keep the show flowing. You don't know where you should, if you feel like it's time to argue a point, and then you get lost in that argument and trying to get out of it, because once you've made the point, you don't want it to turn into an argumentative episode, in other words. So the argument, such as it was in my head anyway, was about whether or not Chris Mellon had potentially leaked his own briefing document online for a few seconds as part of a disinformation campaign, or part of a, not even necessarily that, but part of a PSYOP or something, that it was a planned leak. Not that I know that he did this at all, or even suspect that he did, but given his security background, it's kind of odd, isn't it? But anyway, just that it's something that should be questioned, and Buddy thought not, because he couldn't see a rational reason for this to have happened on purpose. So I didn't belabor that point, but I wanted to make it. And as I was making it and in my head thinking about, okay, how do we segue away? One thing he said about that briefing document was that he was one of the people who had received or somehow acquired a copy of this briefing document, and he decided to leak the anonymous lead source of the Nimitz sighting. Now, I heard that back when I was editing it, and it was one of those things that even as I was editing it, it's almost like some change blindness or something. It's like something you don't expect to hear, and so it takes a while to sink in what's being said. And I talked to my wife, Carol. I'm like, you know, I think this guy said he leaked an anonymous source who didn't want to be identified from this UFO case, which is completely unethical. I need to go back and listen to this. And sure enough, that's what he said. So I asked him about this in a private email exchange, which was fairly lengthy. And he gave his rationalization, claiming that he had taken months to deliberate the pros and cons and all of this. You know, whether it was morally correct to do this. And then ultimately, because the public deserves to know, sure, he went ahead and leaked it. Claiming, he believes, I guess, that if he leaks her name, then she'll step forward and it'll be a big deal, and more people will come to the subject who have integrity. Well, no one comes to the subject with integrity when you can't trust people not to leak their names. I guess that's sort of one, right? But I won't read to you the exchange. In fact, I said I wouldn't do that to him. And he's fine to do that if he would like to. Pretty much as soon as I said I won't be reading our entire exchange on the air, don't worry about that, he came back with, well, maybe I should tell Unknown Country. Maybe I should forward this to unknowncountry.com. Maybe they need to know that this is the way you treat guests. I mean, essentially, he got really upset with my telling him that this was unethical. And based on a delusion, I believe. I can see being defensive about that. I mean, if you're on the receiving end of saying you're unethical, you're behaving unethically in this instance, and I believe delusional based on a delusion, I can see being defensive of that. But for Buddy to present this persona of this rational, completely nice, religious guy, a lot of prayer hands in this back and forth exchange, emoticon. He actually went full on middle school with his just lashing out at me again and again and again, completely unanswered by me, but just kept going with these middle school taunts and insults and things like this and deflection, you know, that sort of Donald Trump thing where he says exactly what he is and what he's doing, but he puts it on everyone else. It's that kind of thing. which he's fine to do. It doesn't actually bother me. What bothers me is this unethical behavior. I mean, I'll read to you what I wrote to him. I feel fine in doing that. I wrote, "It should have been her choice, and you took that away from her. You risked hurting her and her family. What if someone had done that to you in the name of what they declared was the greater good when you were remaining anonymous?" And actually, I didn't realize when I wrote that, he's still remaining anonymous. Buddy is a pseudonym, right? So even though he's putting his face out there, he's not putting his name and stuff out there. But he has no problem taking that away from someone else. And so far, he's in his response to me, he's still civil, actually, even after having said that. But essentially what he says is, to me, the delusional part of this, which is like humanity is at stake, you know? The environmental collapse is upon us. There's a great suffering coming, right? And then, of course, people are going to look back and go, why didn't we do more? And so, you know, he respects my feelings, but he's the hero in the situation, right? So I say, with all due respect, your sense of self-importance and knowing what this ufological story is and where it's going are delusional. And I believe that. And I don't mean that as an insult. I mean that, now I don't mean delusion as in a mental disorder, but delusional, well, let's go to the definition here. If you Google search it, what pops up is delusional, characterized by or holding idiosyncratic beliefs or impressions that are contradicted by reality or rational argument. And then it says typically a symptom of mental disorder. I'm not including that. And then the second definition they have here is delusional, based on or having faulty judgment, mistaken. I mean, absolutely that. And here's why. Because you don't know the future. You don't even know what the unidentified is in unidentified flying objects. You don't know what's going on here. And it's okay to not know that and, you know, get behind the story that you believe to be the case. You're not hurting anyone by doing that. And in fact, even if I don't agree with you, as I don't agree with a lot of what he said on the show, that's not my job, right? So I don't care if I agree or disagree. I'll argue some points here and there. But ultimately, if you're not hurting anyone, it's interesting to hear people's points of view and see why they believe that and, you know, follow along that way. But when you start potentially hurting other people, that needs to be called out. And I went on to say, rationalization is not rationality, and you confuse the two, which is fine for you, but not okay when you're dragging other people into it. Please do examine this. And I guess that was all hugely insulting to him, and I'm impugning his character, and I'm a hypocrite, which doesn't make sense, and blah, blah, blah. In fact, let's examine that I'm a hypocrite, because unfortunately, Buddy doesn't know me at all. He doesn't know anything about me. So what he doesn't understand is that I've actually been down this road with this alleged moral quandary of, do you out the witness? With the Emma Woods case, where Jeff Ritzman and I and then Carol Rainey went after hypnosis big time and David Jacobs' quote-unquote work. And the abuse that he was doing to a woman who went by the pseudonym Emma Woods. And we were harassed to release her name, or else how can we take this seriously? How can we take some anonymous person's testimony against a giant in the field like David Jacobs seriously if, you know, we can't know her name? And you know what that pressure amounted to was no pressure. Because there is no question, there is no, oh, it takes months to deliberate in my mind the morality of this. It's unethical, period. But to me, where the delusion part of this comes into play is actually the difference between ethics and morals. I think in Buddy's mind, it may be unethical to release this name, but it is a morally sound thing to do if the world is ending and aliens are coming to save us in some way. Or if we need to, for, you know, this is the greatest story in all of humanity. So what's one the detriment of one person to the benefit of the many. That's a moral judgment that you make. But if the moral judgment is based on a story that is unprovable, then you've got to, this is where, you know, in an adult world, which I wish ufology was, we would defer to the ethics of the place. The problem is we don't have ethics, right? The problem is there is no universal board of ethics. There is no set of protocols that everyone subscribes to. And I submit to you that if there were ufological ethics, which would be really easy to do, all you would need to do is like look at the various applicable fields in anthropology and medicine, in other investigatory bodies, in the media. You know, you look at all of these various forms of ethics and you take the things that work and that are universally applicable and you go, okay, this is what we're all going to abide by. If we're serious people, we're going to put this little badge on our website saying MUFON now subscribes to, you know, this universal standard of ufological ethics. And this is how we treat people. We're not going to do that, of course, because then you can't have a hypnotist be in charge of alien abductees, because hypnosis is not a good tool and that would be unethical. And I know a lot of you don't like hearing that, and that's tough because that's the truth. That is a fact. And we'll get back to that. So where he really broke down in this exchange and had it out for me in an insulting bunch of ways is when I said that I would need to, I feel I have an obligation to apologize to the audience and talk about ethics. And I said, I won't betray you by reading this email exchange or anything like that. I'm not in it for the arguments or insults. So if you'd like to come back on and respond, I will let you have the last word. Or if you'd like to send me a written response I can read, you know my position, just let me know. And instead of doing either of those things, he just went on an insult tirade, and then, which I don't bother responding to. I just stay at the track of, I'm just trying to be fair, would you like me to read that as your response? It's up to you. And he keeps going on and on with these stupid insults, but eventually agrees to actually come on the show and do a response to this. I say, well, you know what? We can actually do it now. And he says, I can't. I gotta go do some stuff. And then he insults me. And then he says, I'll contact you if I can do it when I come back. And then I never hear from him again. So I'm not going to chase him down. And actually, this is just the springboard. I mean, Buddy isn't really the issue. The larger issue, I think, is this thing of ethics. The fact that there are none in ufology, or at least there's no standardized protocol. It's the Wild West. And it is the reason, I believe, that so many of these groups where they tout PhDs, they tout these scientific names who may be giants in their field, but once they hit ufology, something goes horribly awry. And it's the same problem as reflected in the TV show Night Flyer, which is there aren't those same ethical rules here that they have in their various respective sciences. And so they can go off script, right? And then you end up with something like the Greer Atacama skeleton debacle, where, you know, the scientist Gary Nolan on that case, I don't know what to call it, ends up in hot water with his colleagues because, well, probably because of the way he literally manhandles this skeleton without gloves, or at least someone in this video is doing that in this documentary. Was certainly taken a task for the sense of colonialism going on here, where you can literally pluck the remains of a dead person from another country and treat it as an object, as a thing, with no care in the world for the value that dead person has to his or her relatives, to the culture, to the country from which these remains have been, I mean, essentially stolen. So, you know, this only happens when you are allowed the freedom to leave your ethics at the door. And it's not a conscious thing that happens. It just is. And in fact, I think for those of you who have been listening to Buddy for a while, I mean, he said that he did this months ago. And so if you're still championing him without questioning this, and that's not to question everything Buddy does. It's not to say he's unethical and you know, let's put a scarlet letter on him forever. I'm saying in this instance, this was wrong. And not because I am taking a moral high ground that is judgmental and yada yada in some way that is exclusive to me. I think this is just wrong. And if we had, any sort of, again, ethics in this field, you would have caught that. But because we don't, it's easy to let it go. It's easy to glance over it and go, oh, well, he's talking about the same things I like. I'll overlook this.
We'll be back after this.
The new unknowncountry.com is on the way. There'll be exciting new graphics, much easier navigation, the ability to subscribe either with your credit card or using PayPal, the return of our free message board and subscriber chat room, and so much more. The new site will be intuitive and easy to use, but it will also be demonstrated and explained on Whitley's YouTube channel. As to when, well, we're hopefully just weeks away.
You know, The Afterlife Revolution is a funny book. It makes people happy, even though it's about the afterlife and thinking about crossing over. It made me happy to write it. And the reason it did was that I was actually in touch with Anne while I was writing it. And not only that, she proved it. She proved it clearly and completely. When you read the book, you'll see what I mean. You'll see why Dr. Gary Schwartz, who is one of the leading experts on the afterlife, considers it such an important book, why he wrote a foreword for it. Because this is about something real and incredible that we are told every day not to believe that we have souls and that we have an afterlife. Well, we do. We do. And the Afterlife Revolution is going to open the door for you so you're not going to be thinking to yourself, maybe I don't, when you do. And that's why it's a book of joy. Go on Amazon, take a look at the great reviews, and get yourself a copy. It's available for your Kindle. It's available in paperback. And there's an audiobook read by me. And let me tell you something. You can hear something in my voice. People tell me that, and I think it's true. You know what it is? It's the inner joy that is part of me and has become part of me since this extraordinary thing happened. I have to say, Anne Strieber was a remarkable person in this life, and she still is. Get it today.
Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From Communion to the Afterlife Revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world. Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Strieber.com. That's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there. So don't wait. Go to Strieber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley and only one place to find all his work. Strieber.com.
Welcome back.
Same thing with Jacobs, right? Oh, well, but David Jacobs, that hybrid theory is so tempting to believe in. I'll just overlook his abusive behavior. Or, I've been following the hypnotized literature for so long, and in fact, I've done hypnosis work myself, that I want to believe it despite the evidence. And there's no outside, either not even an enforcement agency, but no outside, even unified sense of a code of ethics that reminds us, oh, right, we shouldn't be doing that. Because apparently humans need this, or at least Westerners need this. I don't know. We need some social pact, some agreement that things are right or wrong, because we could get into our own headspace about morality, about what's the moral thing to do, and it could be in conflict with the greater ethics. If there's no conflict with a greater ethics, then I guess it's just every person for themselves. And this is, you know, perhaps this person that he outed even could see it with a sigh of relief, like, oh, I'm outed, so now thanks, buddy, you just did for me the thing that I needed to do all along but wasn't strong enough to. I mean, who knows? Maybe her reaction is something positive like that. But then my reaction is also to make lemonade out of lemons by doing this show. So the outcome for the person isn't even the issue. The issue is not doing it in the first place. And again, I mean, I think if we had like a code of ethics for ufology, this would put a nail in the coffin of at least part of what the trickster theory is about, which is like anyone who enters this field just becomes like sort of crazed. They go off the deep end at some point. These rational people become irrational. And I think that is because, for whatever reason, it's not like a trickster thing. It's that it is the Wild West. And with great freedom should come great responsibility, but instead becomes the id. And we see this with the internet, right? Where this wonderful, vast resource becomes a haven for trolling and bullying and just whatever we, you know, hurting each other. like not everybody, obviously, but too many of us. Because we're not personally disciplined enough, and therefore we do need those outside rules that are a societal agreement, or in the ufological case, a sort of subculture agreement, that this is the way we will behave. This is the way we will, you know, journalists don't out sources. So, hey, that's a good standard. Let's adopt that. And if you don't adopt that, then you are not to be taken seriously as a disseminator of information, right? Like, that's pretty simple. And if you do break that, then you're allowed to make it up. Or, you know what I mean? Like, even restaurants who get failing ratings are allowed to clean up their act. So again, I'm not saying, oh, buddy is forever tainted by this or anything like that. But I think he owes this woman an apology, and I think he needs to rethink his sense of ethics here. But then I also think anyone out there who heard this, who wasn't outraged by it, also needs to rethink their sense of ethics here, if they caught it. It's funny, it reminds me of this, there was this guy when I was in high school who used to stand on his lawn every day at the same time and out front. And the rumor was that his son had been lost in Vietnam, and every day he comes outside at the same time and stands at the front waiting for his son to come home. Which, by the late 80s, early 90s, becomes a sad sort of delusional thing that he does. And that's fine. Until he starts, you know, if he started yanking on passersby's arms, demanding that they tell him where his son is, that becomes a problem. Right? Like, I don't know, this just kind of reminded me of that. And I don't know that that's true about that guy either. It was just a rumor. You know how kids are. But I want to remind everyone that for, I don't know, how long has it been? Like 60 plus years of this? The thinking that has defined this field the whole time has been, if we just find that one solid case, we'll be taken seriously by seriously minded scientists. And by the media. But the serious minds won't actually take you seriously if you're not serious. And part of being serious is abiding by a code of ethics. When I first started writing for UFO Magazine way back when, I had written an article about the need for the field to be policed. And I remember people were up in arms about that. How dare you? Who are you to police the field? And that's partly right, because I was partly wrong. I wasn't thinking about, oh, right, we just need a code of ethics. Like, because I remember Richard Dolan telling me, well, who's going to, because I was saying, like, peer review, let's do peer review. And he said, well, who's going to peer review me? And right now I hear Tyler Cokejohn in my head going, I'll do it. But right, before we have peer review, we need to have a definition of what a peer is. And the only way to have a definition of what a peer is to have enough people abide by, again, a standardized code of ethics. From that follows everything else that creates the air of legitimacy that somebody like Buddy seeks. It's not finding this one case that everyone's going to go, aha, because we've been doing that forever. Everything that Buddy said in the last week's episode, the thing that I find kind of funny about it, in everybody, you know, who says, oh, I really relate to what he's saying. Well, yeah, of course you do, because you've heard it all 8,000 times over the years. This next case is the biggest case. It's going to be the one that breaks the door wide open. We're ready for this. You know, that whole thing. Wash, rinse, repeat. Now, my own personal take, as you know, is that none of this unfolds through any sort of disclosure, because it ain't about that. But I could be wrong, right? So I would not act morally on my belief, because I could be wrong. And then I've acted out of a moral sense of, you know, indignation on something that is incorrect. For all I know, this phenomenon truly is aliens from another planet, and there really are documents that are, you know, all that. I don't believe it. I don't think the evidence shows it, but I could be wrong. But if that's the type of story we engage with to energize us to look into this and all of that, well, maybe that's fine. Maybe there's something to that. But don't let it take over your thinking to the extent that everything else is excluded except, you know, paying lip service to it. Because there's a real danger there, and the danger is once you, in your head, honestly think you know exactly what's going on, then yeah, it's really easy to make that choice to potentially harm other people to further the greater good that you just know is real. You just know it's the rational thing. And funny enough, as I was looking up Buddy and this situation, I found an article on Mysterious Universe, who I actually have had major disagreements with about hypnosis and all of that, Jacobs. But on this, I think they get it right. And this article, dated August 12th, 2018, leaked Nimitz UFO report reveals names of sources, MJ Banyas is the author. He says at the very end, quote, at time of publication, the unredacted Nimitz document has only surfaced in a few private Facebook groups and private forums. Fortunately, most of those in possession of the document have respectfully redacted the names of those pilots who wish to remain anonymous. In situations such as this, privacy and anonymity are paramount. It must be respected, and we can only hope that everyone who possesses these files now will protect the rights of those individuals named in the report. As the UFO community, it seems to be our job to keep secrets now, because those who do possess them clearly have trouble doing so. End quote. I couldn't agree more. Well, except for the part about UFO community. We're not really a community until we all have a standard of ethics, right? And of course, these aren't the only areas where there's been major ethical concerns. The transparency in ufology, issues of chain of custody, issues of data dissemination in other ways. I mean, remember when MUFON went on TV and just started alerting the world to these massive radar hits happening? I think it was over Texas. And then that all turned out to be normal. And it's like, what? Is there no standard for coming out and saying stuff? Like, do they not have a protocol for that? Like, we can do better, and we should do better, if there's going to be a we at all. And it's funny how people push back against that. I mean, how many people have I interviewed or just spoken to who are part of an organization or are enthusiastic about getting a message out there who don't know me at all, but they assume, because I'm talking about this stuff, that we're all on the same page. And when you say something that, or when I say something that I find to be factually accurate, if it goes, if it rubs against the grain of what they believe, there's a problem. And much like with Buddy, you know, it starts off civil and it ends up in a tirade of insults and just defense mechanisms going up. And who the hell are you to tell me to blah, 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 blah? I mean, that's what you do when your belief is being attacked, right? Or you perceive your belief to be attacked. But I think pointing out other possibilities, or even the possibility that you were wrong or misidentified something in your own experiences, should be welcomed, right? Like, if we honestly want to get to the truth of something, how many times do you have to explain what those orbs are in those orb photos? And then, of course, after you explain, it's a droplet of water, it's a mosquito, it's a whatever. Then it falls on deaf ears, even when I do something like that and then follow up with, but there are real orbs. It's just these aren't those. Because they want these to be real, because these are the ones that they experienced, you see? So it's not about the actual discernment of fact from fake or, you know, in-camera digital illusion from an actual phenomenon. We may talk a good game about caring about that, but when it comes down to actual, you know, your actual experiences, well, by God, those are all real because I experienced them. Or my take on this is real and correct because I've thought about it for so long. I couldn't possibly have been wasting my time. And you're just a debunker. Which. All right. If you're a non-subscriber, you didn't hear my entire tirade. So please, by all means, click that subscribe tab and get this and all episodes of The Experience in their entirety commercial free. All of Dreamland the same way. And I will see you next week. Take care, everybody.